Nothing's great. You know, but the reality is that God gave us like this building at half price, which was amazing. We walked away. We were like, we're not taking this building. It's too expensive. We can't afford it. Da, 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 da. He's prophesying stuff like that. And we're like, but we're going to, you know, if God says it, God can make it half price. And the guy called us back like literally 2 or 3 months later. He didn't, like, it wasn't right away. And 2 or 3 months later, he calls us up and says, okay, I feel like I'm going to give it to you for this price if that would be acceptable to you. And it was exactly half, which is what my wife had prayed privately, didn't tell anybody, even me. You know, we'll work on that. She prayed in secret, and it was confirmation to her that, and she was the one really wanting to make sure that was God for financial reasons, because, you know, she does a lot of stuff that is just helping a lot of people. And when you're helping a lot of people, you know, we don't have the same finances other churches have, because we have a lot of people we're supporting, we're helping get on their feet, you know, and it just costs a lot of money. And I personally work because I just believe in that. I take no salary. I don't really need a salary. I just want to help people, you know. You told the Lord.
I told the Lord I'd rather help people than have a building, because I could have a tent and still help people.
It would be hot and it would be cold. Right now it would be really cold. But we would work. God would work it out, Whitney. So that's a big deal. We're gonna have a volunteer meeting right after service. If you're interested in helping out, or if you're interested, or if you don't have any funds and you need to help out, those are your privileges. So after service, we're gonna come up here and we're gonna meet together. If you can help out, it also, you know, eventually we'll have such a good team that we won't need as many volunteers on key areas. But it's also a way to get to meet people that you normally wouldn't get to meet in a conference, because you'd be serving in the back and being able to help out. So we want to have, I told every volunteer, if you can't give us your A game, your best day for Jesus, you're serving the Lord in a really important conference to us and to this region. We're believing God's going to really, really touch lives. We're believing for some really incredible manifestations of the Spirit. So if you guys want to hear how to pray, that's what we're believing God for. We're believing God for very impacting supernatural releases. We're believing God for transformations of heart. Because when people see the supernatural, guess what happens? Peter, John, Jesus says, throw your nets on the other side of the boat. They caught so many fish that it took them into an encounter. Some people don't really understand why blessings are important, but it was really important to John and Peter, because Jesus is on the boat preaching and teaching, but he says, here, we're going to go out, and I want you to go out. You're going to cast your net on the other side. They've been like, we've already been fishing, and we're fishers, and you're rabbi. We're the fishermen, you're the rabbi. But because you said it, we don't want to disrespect you, rabbi. We're going to go fishing together with the rabbi. Catch nothing. It's going to be great. They go out fishing with the rabbi, expecting nothing, and they throw their nets out, and when they go to pull up their nets, the boats begin to almost sink with the power, with the weight of the catch. So much weight, so much. Do you know that glory actually represents riches or weight? And so that kabod, as it's coming and they're pulling up these nets, their boats are almost sinking. They're like, they realize, who is this guy? Catch it, catch it, catch it. The encounter of blowing their natural mind opened their heart to the reality that heaven could impart. And so a lot of times we're trying to get understanding from God. God doesn't give understanding to your head. He gives understanding to your heart. Your heart expands. Your heart discovers it, and then it begins to increase in your mind. So it's going to be a powerful time. We're really, really, really excited that you guys will be here, and really excited. We're already up and looking into the 200s for how many people are going to be here. And that's without the last week push. So if you have Facebook and can share it, please get on there and just push it out. to your friends or put it on your personal thing. It's free advertising for you to help the church let people know. And here's the main thing. It's all about you believing that God's going to do something supernatural for somebody enough that you're going to invite them. If you believe that God's going to do something significant, then you're going to want people to come. And so that's the key, is really your faith being stirred up to know that God wants to move in our lives. Amen? All right, so let's get started. Thank you, Jesus. Huh? Yeah, I heard. Anyway, I don't want to get lost. So, God, we thank you. There's a leadership meeting on Wednesday. If you can come out. We're really, really starting to get more and more people are coming on board. They're getting excited about what God's doing here. I just had a meeting with a great family who was with David and Tracy Ruhlman. They were with Mike and Rose Greer. And then they were with David and Tracy Ruhlman. And then they were like, we want to be here. And we feel like the Lord wants us to be here. And they live in Southern Maryland and have 5 kids. And they homeschool and they love education. And you love children. Come on. Actually, I had all of the kids in my office. I was like, this is awesome. I had like kids stacked up on me. So I think kids are awesome. I think kids are awesome. I know a lot of people don't like kids. They feel like an inconvenience if you let them feel that way. But they're awesome. Yeah, we've been around a lot of pastors that kind of like, they had the children's church as the children's babysitting to get the children out of the way. But we really, really, really want to pour into our children. We want our children, we do believe that our children have the ability to do what we're doing. And the sooner they can do it, the quicker they can get out of believing that they're just children. I remember my son preached, the first time he preached, he was 12. I was like, hey, Freddie, you can't believe that you need all this stuff. You need to believe that God is able to use you at 12 like he was all these people in the Bible. They weren't some superheroes. They were literally kids in the Bible that were doing exploits for God, that were prophesying, that were having visions, that were interpreting visions. They were having these encounters with God because they believed it was possible. It's time that we believe that our children can have these encounters, can pray for the sick and be healed. It's time we believe that blind eyes can be opened by their hands because the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in our kids. Amen? I'm excited about that. Sorry, I got a little lost. But we're having a leadership meeting. We're excited if you can be there. If you're interested in the prophetic team or any of the new stuff we're going after, I think a lot of people have been coming to you lately, huh? Yeah, see, I think you better up your game because they're coming. They are coming. So, Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time. And we just ask for this atmosphere, Lord, to be pregnant with your purpose. The word of God, Lord, manifest among us. We ask, Father, that the heavens be open over everyone in this room. And we just command every mind to yield to the presence of God and Holy Spirit. Just listen and get your attention set on him. And the blood of Jesus is here to cleanse you from all unrighteousness, that he may take you from a place where you once were into a place you've never seen yourself being. And I believe today there's going to be some breakthroughs for some people in this room that once thought they were stuck, maybe even yesterday, thinking how stuck you are, how long is this season going to be? And I believe by the end of this service, you're going to be in a place that you've never believed that God could take you. And it's going to be a quick work in the name of Jesus. We're believing God for a suddenly in this place. In the name of Jesus, can you guys say amen? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Well, I have an amazing son in the Lord here that was telling me about how excited he was to be talking about. He's like, what are we going to do? How are we going to talk about fasting? What are we going to say about prayer? This is exciting. And he's like, should we have like a panel, or can we do this, or can we do that? I was like, Joseph, you know, let's pray about it. And I started praying, and I just, every time I would pray about it, I would see Joseph speaking with me. And I said, Joseph, come on, we're going to speak together, and we're just going to talk about the goodness of the Lord, and we're going to be talking about the power that is released in fasting and prayer. Amen? So we have a couple things we weren't able to share this morning in this activation at the end. If you'll give us the grace to do it. Amen.
Amen. Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. How many of y'all are thankful for the Lord today?
Yes.
Amen. How many of you guys want to be like Pastor David at that conference and do that? I want to be like that.
Oh, okay.
Not right now, though.
Not right now. Okay.
I said, hey, you better go.
Oh, it's all
that
fun
was
and
good.
Games.
No, it was good.
Yeah.
I loved it. I love this man so very much. You know, when you laid hands on me earlier, I was already toasted. Like, I'm trying not to be. I stand up here. But when you did and you put your hand on my belly, I heard the Lord keep saying, covenant, covenant, covenant. And it was just like a sealing of an assignment. And I felt that for myself, he was speaking it to me, and he just showed me, never let go of the covenant that I have with you, with Pastor Tracy. So I'm very grateful for the both of you. And I just want to verbally and publicly say that. So thank you. Yay. Everybody
That's
say,
awesome.
Aw. Praise the Lord. So, but we're going to talk about prayer and fasting since we are on a fast right now, 21-day fast.
Yeah. Amen. So we're going to open to Isaiah 58. If you're not really fasting type, you know, I wasn't built for fasting, as you could tell. I'll suck it in a little bit. I wasn't built for fasting. I was made to enjoy the goodness of the Lord and the fat of the land. In fact, I was convincing everybody earlier that bacon is on the Daniel fast. So the point is that nobody likes to deny themselves. The question is, do you like where you're at? Or do you want to pursue God even deeper? Do you want to dig in and go after what God is opening up to you, opening up to us? Because we're believing God for some supernatural things that should be pretty mind-boggling. The supernatural opens up a place, to finish my story with Peter and John. Here's what the outcome was. How can we be saved? If we want the world around us to be saved, we have to understand the easiest way for people to get saved is to have an encounter that shows them what you know is not enough. There's a world outside of what you know that you have barely touched, barely thought about, barely understood. And God, when he starts opening up just the peak of his heart, it's like it will take you to your knees and cause you to hunger for those things. And when God opens up his heart and causes you to hunger for those things, you'll never be the same. There won't, if somebody tells me to stand on my head or whatever it takes, I'm going for it. Get up here if you're hungry for God. I'm going to be knocking down grandmas. I'm sorry. I'll pray for you when I get back. I'm going to go get my anointing and I'll come and pray for you, grandma, but you're going down. Y'all think that's mean. I'm saying I'm hungry and grandma's going to go down. If she might. If she's hungry, she might run me down. All right, do I need to use a different illustration? She's not happy with the grandma illustration, but I'm just saying. If grandma got ran over by a reindeer, grandma's going to run me over. I pray that we have some hungry people that will run me over. Come on. I'm looking for some comrades. Come on. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah. That's awesome. I love that. Come on. Boldness. That's what I'm talking about. 73. I was going to say 73. 73 years old, spunky as anybody, and hungry for God. She's going on our missions trip with us to India. Amen. So I'm just saying, if you could go on a missions trip, then you know you got a lot of spunk in you. You're ready. You're ready to do the things of God. So my point actually was that I don't really hold back when it comes to somebody saying, this will get you where God wants you. I don't care. I don't know that I'll pay $1,000 for a piece of sand from some desert somewhere. But, you know, I have a problem with TV evangelists telling me those things. But I do really go after God if I feel like it's from a sincere heart. Yes. If it's from a sincere heart, I don't care what it takes. I'm going for it. Amen. And so we're going to start in this Isaiah 58. And this is the why fast. Why should I fast? You're going to hear some promises in here that should cause you to challenge yourself, because God's going to take the very essence of why we do what we do, and he's going to turn it around to make people around us hungry for the things of God. So, Joseph.
Okay, so Isaiah 58. We're actually going to start at verse 6.
Verse 6 this time.
Yes. Isaiah 58, verse 6. You just follow along in your Bibles. It says, is not this the fast that I have chosen? This is the Lord talking, okay? Is not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the bands of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, that ye break every yoke. Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out of thy house? when thou seest the naked, thou covereth him, and that thou would not hide your face from your own flesh. Then your light shall break forth as the morning, and your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your reward.
Rear guard.
Then you will call, and he will answer. You will cry, and he will say, here I am. If you will take away from you the yoke, the putting forth of the finger, and speaking wickedly, and if you draw out your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light will rise in darkness, and your obscurity will be as the noonday. And the Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in dry places and make strong your bones. And you will be like a well-watered garden, like a springs whose waters fail not. And they that will be of thee will build the old waste places. They shall raise up the foundations of many generations, and they will be called the repair of the breach, the restorer of the paths to dwell in.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That's a lot of promise in there, right? And yes. And it starts with me getting my heart straight. You know, fast, I used to think fast is like the quick way to get all the junk to come up all at the same time. Now, I could see why we wouldn't exactly want that idea to happen, you know, but you turn up the heat, you're going to get the stuff that comes to the surface. And so it's kind of like if you talk about God the refiner. God the refiner. You guys know that God is a refining fire. Guess what the refiner does? He stokes the fire that brings the things that will bring out the stuff. Why? Because he's looking for gold, and the stuff doesn't belong in the gold. I'm talking about hearts. He likes hearts that are refined. And so in this place here, it's talking about your bones being strengthened. Bones represent, you guys heard that the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, able to cut between soul and spirit, bone and marrow. The marrow is the life of the body, or the life is in the blood, Hebrews says. So life is actually given when the blood was given, like the blood of Jesus. It was poured out, and without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. So here's where it goes. Life comes, and when life comes, I'm actually able to enjoy the structure in which I'm living in. So a lot of times, you know, we end up getting ourselves in a place where we build so much structure around us that eventually the life in which God had to operate and move in our lives ends up drying up, and we end up being like the children of Israel when Ezekiel was taken to this place called the Valley of Dry Bones, right? What happens to dry bones? First thing, very brittle. They're very unflexible, right? They're very brittle. They're unflexible. They have no life in them. And when you lose the very essence of the marrow is what generates, guess what? It generates blood, which is the life. So marrow generates blood. And because it's the source of life, guess what it represents? Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit fills those structures that we put. And if the Holy Spirit's not filling a structure, we need to knock it down. Amen. Come on, y'all been in church too long. If there's a structure that's not housing God, it's not a structure that we want in our lives. Amen to that. I want structures that house God. I want structures that have flexibility for God. And what it's saying here, when we fast, we're sensitive to the fact that our bones have life. There's life coming out of the structures in my life. There's life coming out of the fact that I go to church, not just a routine. There's life coming out of the fact that I'm a giver, not just routine. There's life coming when I lift my hands, when I worship. It's real. It's real. It's not something I do out of a habit. It's not something I do to make people think I'm spiritual. I'm not interested in people in worship. I'm not interested in people when I give. I'm interested in God. And when I worship, I only want one guy coming to me. I want God to come and fill the structure of my life and transform every part of me so that life can be in me. That when I speak, life comes out of me. It's so easy that way. So when I get life in me, guess what happens? The next part says I get to be part of the raise. It says, I will those among you will rebuild the ancient ruins, and you will rise up age-old foundations, and you'll be called repairer of the breach. In other words, there's going to be so much life in you. When you come around others, they're going to start feeling the pull of heaven that's going to call them upward, that's going to cause them to start to rebuild the things that they were put in your life to, as they start to build the things that they were called to build. So everyone around you will get inspiration because of the life in you. When they see life in you, they start remembering what they're all about. Where am I going? Am I going and you start asking yourself the right questions because you see someone with life. You see marriages with life. You see people with hearts. You see people with love. And you start going, I want that. And you start repairing the breach. And as you start repairing this chasm, as a breach would be called, like a chasm, as you start repairing that place, you will raise up the age-old foundations. And the next part is that this term was actually the same term used for Jesus, by the way. It was called the repairer of the breach. John the Baptist made straight the path of the Lord, right? He repaired the breach so that Jesus could come, rather. And so when we're talking about fasting and prayer, the first part is I stop focusing so much inwardly. I start focusing upwardly, and God starts giving me an outward focus to all those around me. So my fast automatically should be about what I can give to God and what I can give to others, because otherwise it's not God's fast. It's not supposed to be about me getting my breakthroughs, even though that sounds really good preaching. It's supposed to be about me getting in tune with heaven. And when I get in tune with heaven, then I can begin to connect with heaven. And as I'm connected, then heaven starts to pour through me. And all the rest is supposed to be, guess what? Added to me. If I seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these other things shall be added unto me. All right, Joseph, come on. It's all warmed up for you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So I want to read. I felt led of the Lord to read from this great book. It's called Contact with God. And she has just some principles about fasting that I felt led to share. I'm just going to read this and then we'll continue on. She says, fasting before God is one of the greatest secrets to a rich life full of fruitful intercession. During a fast, the appetites of the flesh are put aside. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The appetites, your desires of your flesh are put aside, and the spirit becomes more sensitive to hear God's voice. And I dare say, if your spirit is not the dominant voice when you're fasting, you're not fasting. And that was by the Spirit of God. I've never said that before. If your spirit is not the dominant voice, if all you hear is what you want to do or what you're not able to do over what the spirit man inside of you is saying, then you're not actually not fasting. So anyway, she says that fasting throughout the biblical history, especially in the Old Testament, people fasted for several different reasons. During times of sorrow, mourning, and great affliction, people would fast to express their grief, of course, and that was under the law. But in the New Testament, Jesus gave the church no definite pattern for fasting. Perhaps it was because he didn't want it to become a formula to follow. If any time that you get to a place where you're just doing things to do it, I'm trying to think of who said that. Anyway, I'll try and think of it later. But anytime that there's a repetition for doing things just to do it instead of because God say it, that's actually the birthplace of religion.
Yeah.
That's the birthplace of a religious mindset. Oh, I'm just going to do it because every January everybody fasts and we're all going to fast for 21 days and we're going to do this Daniel fast. No, what did God say? How did God tell you to fast? Now, this is different. This is a corporate fast. So in a corporate fast, the instructions are given to, and I love the way how they did this time, was they said, we as a corporate body will be fasting. There's some people doing a Daniel fast. There's some people doing a liquid fast. There's some people, it's how the Lord has directed you to fast. But everyone, if you are part of this corporate assembly, should be fasting something. Amen. That is the truth. It's different when it's a personal fast, but if it's a corporate fast set forth by the people that God has placed in this house, everyone should fast something. And how do you know what to fast? We'll be talking about that. But I'll go on here and say, she says, fasting doesn't only involve abstaining from food. It is a lifestyle of abstinence from certain carnal pleasures that would take your time and thoughts away from God. Therefore, when we truly fast, we don't touch anything that would distract us from a consecrated prayer life. I said this in the first service. There's so many people that fast and pray and, you know, we'll play video games, we'll watch movies, we'll go this, we'll still talk bad about this person, we won't walk in love, we'll still do everything and still in the name of saying that we're fasting. I'm telling you now, I was going to say 9 times out of 10, it actually just does not work. Okay? That's the work of the flesh. It's not something that we should be entertaining when we're fasting because, again, we're cultivating our spirits to hear what it is that God's saying and then being able to release that into the earth. Anything that would distract us. That's why Paul even said, he said that when he was talking to married couples in the New Testament, he said that they can abstain from having a sexual relationship with each other when they're fasting, but it has to be by mutual consent. Why? Because that is there's the appetite of the flesh that's conquered when the two people come together. But that is a part of abstaining. And Paul said that when you're fasting, it is appropriate to fast from that type of behavior and it's by consent. Thank God it's by consent for those that are married. Hallelujah, be in agreement. And if you're not married, be just like he said, just thank God for the grace to keep you from burning. Hallelujah. Amen. Let me keep one. I'm going off on this. Ha-ha. She says, the third point, she says, Jesus demanded that when we seek God by fasting, we should not do so as hypocrites do. We should not wear a sad countenance and make a big issue of fasting. I hear so many of us, you know, we all complain sometimes when we're fasting. I've been guilty of it. All of us have. But our countenance should be bright. When we fast, we are not fasting to gain the approval of men. We are fasting for God. The purpose of fasting, I love this, is to draw near to Almighty God and to bring him into our midst so that he can draw others into his presence. It was just like Pastor David just said. We fast so that our heart can be prepared for God to come in and touch someone else's life. The fasting doesn't even have anything to do with us. So if we are being selfless, we will see souls saved. But if we are being selfish, you won't touch anyone but yourself. And what good is that going to do or benefit the body of Christ when all that God does is always for the benefit of someone else? Amen? She says here, just two more points. Those that are fat, actually, yeah, two more points. Those who have been seen of men get an acclaim of men. They get the very thing that they want when they're trying to fast to, you know, get the approval of men. Jesus even said that they have the reward. But those are not the followers that Jesus wants. Fasting should never be an act of hardship, but it should be an act of joy. Joy. We should be encountering joy when we're on this fast. I don't know about y'all, but ever since we started, I've had nothing but joy. I've been laughing sometimes. And I'm like, you have nothing to laugh about. I'm just walking through my house. I'm like, what is the matter with me? And I hadn't even read this book yet. And I'm looking like, wow, I'm not crazy. Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Who else has been experiencing joy? Praise God. That's good. That's right. I'm not alone. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus said, appear not unto men to fast, but unto the Father which sees in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Fasting was not observed to try and change God or force him to have to move his hand. That is not the purpose of fasting. The purpose of fasting is to become more consecrated and sensitive to the Lord. And as I read this, and I was studying for this, I kept seeing the purpose, the purpose, the purpose. It kept coming up in my heart as it was like jumping out of the page. And so this is what I got. What is the purpose of this fast? Why are we on this fast? Purpose means the reason why something is done or used, the aim or the intention of something, the feeling of being determined to do or achieve something, the aim or the goal of a person, what a person is trying to do or to become. And when I asked Pastor David last night when we were studying what his and Pastor Tracy's heart was for this fast, they said the purpose of this fast is to release a cleansing over Redemption House Life Center, yes, Lord, as a whole. Repentance. And why I just dipped there, I said, Lord, what about the ones that don't want to do it? They will be quickly removed. Quick, and that wasn't me, that was him. Quickly removed. Because God's not playing games anymore. After midnight, there was something that struck. And I said, he's not playing anymore. It's like, Pastor David's been saying it. You have been. You've been saying it. Remember he kept talking about this line of demarcation. He said, this is it. We're either going to be for God or we're not. And there's so many people, Pastor Tracy's been saying it, prophesying it. There's so many of an influx of people that's getting ready to come into this house that cannot see contamination, that cannot see the world. They have to literally see the genuine truth of God and his love. So there's a releasing, he's releasing a cleansing over Redemption House Life Center as a whole. That's the purpose of this fast. Yes, ma'am? The world. They cannot see the contamination of the world. Oh, Lord.
They're coming in here to see something different. I'm so sick of hearing people say, I go to church and it's no different than the world. I'm tired of it. I'm putting an end by every power and everything and every authority that Jesus has given me to put an end to it. So don't come up here in this house and be all over each other anymore. I'm tired of seeing it. Keep your relationships if you're not married, and if you are married, please be respectful. But if you're single, keep your relationships outside those doors. You have youth in here. You have children. You have single people. You have people unsaved coming in this house. God is calling us to a level of holiness. I do not want to see anybody be removed from this ministry if you're called to be here. That is not my heart. But my heart is to be, for the Lord to release what he's called to release and for people to stop hindering it. There are people that have been called to be here and God has not let them come for the simple fact that I have two teenagers on themselves in the back row at times. It's been dealt with, trust me. You come into holiness. The sanctuary is holy. You either get right with God and live holy, crucify your flesh and deny yourself, or please, come back when you can. We do love you, and we want you here. But I'm not willing to let our youth and our children see things that are being led by adults that are not right. And it's not holy. When these kids are pure, and they're trying to live pure,
so the purpose of this fast, we're releasing a cleansing over Redemption House as a whole. That's what they felt like. A time of setting apart to prepare ourselves for the Lord and all that he has promised. Just, I actually feel this right now. Forgive me, Lord, for trying to be in a rush. So everyone lift up their hands and thank God for what that word we just received. Don't clap. Just lift your hands. Just thank him for it because that's a gift. That's actually the mercy of God saying, get it right. That's actually the mercy of God saying, come to repentance. And for some of us that's been struggling and just said, oh, I can't help it. I can't stop. I can't stop talking to this person. I can't stop having sex with this person. I can't stop doing the thing that's causing me to be, you know, whatever, to be easily beset like the scripture says. No, this is an invitation for holiness. And you can do it. And you will do it. That's what I hear the Lord saying. You can and you will. There's help. There's grace that's provided for each and every one of us. And it's right now for this season. But he will not help you if you do not want it. We have to want it. We have to cultivate a desire and a hunger for holiness. Again, he's releasing a cleansing over Redemption House Life Center. Repentance, a setting apart to prepare ourselves for all that the Lord has promised. Calling things into existence that God has declared ours while the Spirit is hovering with grace over this time. And the last thing they said was to be sensitive to the direction of the Holy Spirit. And for those that were in this morning service, my God, was that evident. It was amazing this morning. So I wrote this, that the purposes of God that he has for us individually and corporately in this hour are eternal. They are from and ultimately move us towards God's eternal heart. What he's asking us to do right now is not affecting us just because he wants it to affect us now. Everything that he's asking us to do, it's because it's eternal. It's the eternal plan of God, what his big picture is, you know? So according to the pastors that they spoke on New Year's Eve, for those that you were here, they said that we would begin to walk in and live out all of the prophetic words that have been spoken over this house by the Lord. Can somebody say amen to that? But these words come with a purpose. Those prophetic words that have been declared over this house come with a purpose. They have an effect on God's eternal plan for our lives and for this house. How do we know that? Because our heart's cry is to reach the lives of those in need with the real, authentic presence of God who is love. Souls are in. There's an influx of souls. There's going to be an influx of kids. There's going to be an influx of children and young adults and things like that. There's so much that God wants to do, and he's preparing us as a body for it. And those are the words that are going to come to pass, and they are eternal. But these will not fall on us like ripe cherries off of tree, like Kenneth Hagin says. They're not, you know, when fruit ripens on a tree, it just falls. It's not going to do that. We have a part to play. So many times I've heard it said so many times, well, whatever God wants to happen, he's going to make it happen in my life. How many of us have heard that? I'm not going to ask if you said it. Because if you said it, that's wrong. Do you know how we know that's wrong? Does God get everything that he wants? No. How do we know that? Are there people dying and going to hell? Does he desire them to die and go to hell? Is he getting what he wants? No. And do you know why? Because the sovereign will of God is to give men free will, to choose him, to choose righteousness, to choose the right way of living and doing. And when we don't choose that, we choose against what he wills. So whatever God wants to happen in this hour for this house, it will only happen when we work with God. The old folks used to say there is a working with God. Pastor David calls it partnering with God. And I said it in the first service. There is a difference between just praying and then working with God. If you've ever had the privilege of working with God on an assignment, my God, it changes your life. Because you literally see God himself coming in to work and influence in someone else's life to literally change them and make in them a person that looks just like who he is. And that in itself is amazing. So now we're going to talk about praying our purpose. I just want to read this quick passage here. She says, how the word and prayer operate together. Contained within the word of God are his instructions for mankind. In other words, God tells his people how to live as he wants them to live. But this is not enough. Once you understand God's plan, then you have to set it into motion. And that is where prayer comes in. Everyone say that. That is where prayer comes in. Say, we've got to pray. If we want those words to come to pass, we have to pray with our fasting, you know. So she says here that it is not enough to simply have a Bible study. That is wonderful, but you must follow it up with prayer. You must have the word, but it takes prayer to animate the word, to make it alive. It takes prayer to execute God's plan. It takes the Holy Spirit to live this life within you. Prayer should be an ongoing practice in your life, for prayer is an eternal work. Prayer is an eternal work. It literally brings eternity into the now. That's how important prayer is with fasting. And how do we know that? There's a great example. If you turn in your Bibles to chapter 9. I'm going to read this very quickly. Daniel chapter 9. And we're going to just read 1 through 6. It says, it was the first year of the reign of Darius the Mede, the son of Ahasuerus, who became the king of the Babylons. During the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, learned from reading the word of the Lord, as was revealed to the prophet Jeremiah, that Jerusalem must lie desolate for 70 years. So look at that. He found out what God's will was by reading the word. He read the prophet Jeremiah, and he was able to know through the vision that he had had. Anybody that, you know, has read Daniel knows the story. But during that time, he was studying Jeremiah, and he saw, wow, okay, Israel's 70th week is getting ready to end as far as this desolation is concerned. So he says, so I turned to the Lord God and pleaded with him in prayer and fasting. I also wore rough burlap. Thank God we don't have to wear that anymore. And sprinkled myself with ashes. Notice he said, I turned to the Lord and pleaded with him with prayer and fasting. He didn't just have knowledge of what was going on. He found that out through reading the word. So it's just like this. This is the pattern. We find out what God's purpose is for this fast. We just read it. So now we attach prayer and fasting to understand it, to understand the word, to understand the prophecies that are coming. Fasting and prayer has been added to it so that we can understand it. And it's interesting in the Hebrew there, the Hebrew actually says that he requested prayer while he was praying. He didn't know what to pray. So he said, I don't know what to pray. Grant me the prayer to pray, because I don't know. Isn't that awesome? He didn't just come in saying, oh, God, you said 70th weeks, and this is the 70th week, and Lord, I'm thanking you because this is what you said. No, he said, I don't even know how to pray. So he requested prayer with fasting, and verse 4 said, I prayed. This is the prayer that he prayed. I prayed to the Lord, my God, and confessed, oh, Lord, you are a great and awesome God. You always fill your covenant and keep your promises of unfailing love to those who love you and obey your commandments. But we have sinned and done wrong. We have rebelled against you and scorned your commands and regulations. We have refused to listen to your servants, the prophets, who spoke on your authority to our kings and princes and ancestors and to all of the people of the land. Notice the first thing when he requested prayer, the prayer that was granted to him was repentance. Repentance should be the first occurrence, the first prayer that we are praying through this fasting.
Amen. So I want to make sure that we understand Daniel's prayer. Now, Daniel would be considered the model Christian.
Yeah.
Okay? Daniel is really important because how Daniel perceived himself in the midst of God actually transformed his prayer. Because when we get living right, sometimes we start looking down on people that aren't living right. But that's actually not the way of the Word of God. It's not the heart of God. In fact, Jesus, in the midst of a sinful people, came and became sin for man. Here's Daniel praying the same prayer, just like Jesus. He prayed the prayer, Lord God, forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our rebellion. Here's a man saying, I've been rebellious. And he's not the one who was rebellious at all. In fact, he's the one that's standing and praying in front of his window, getting ready to get killed, thrown into the lion's den, living for his faith, not caring about his own life for God. And here he is when he gets into prayer because he starts getting the heart of God is, I am the people. That's where you know you really understand intercession. Intercession is becoming sin for the region. Not living above sin and feeling like the region needs to get not so icky and not so yucky and people are disgusting but they need to get themselves together. No, we are the people together. And he came and became involved and intimate with, and he says, we are the people Israel who were rebellious. We sinned against God, and in that likeness he was able to bring the people out instead of bringing himself out. God doesn't want us to bring ourselves out. He wants us to bring a whole people out, a whole tribe out. He wants us to become so aware of who the people are around us that we connect with them, so that if God, if you're going to take me, you're going to take them too. This is how Moses operated too. He says, you're not going to kill me and start over with me. And I mean, you're not going to kill them and start over with me. That's not who you are. People need to understand God's heart so they can pray his heart, so they can pray what he's praying. So part of repentance is really becoming the one with the people around you and not so much becoming one with God. You are one with God, but you're also one with the people. And you can't disconnect from either. So the conundrum is, don't disassociate yourself, because the same way you didn't think you were worthy to be saved and then you met Jesus, the same way when you meet Jesus, it doesn't make you not worthy to connect with the same people that you came out of. And so really, if you want to know what Redemption House is all about, it's about being one with the people and not forgetting the people and who God called us to serve. So we're serving the people around us. We're one with the people. And when we talk, I pray you never hear us talking down. And if you do, you know, maybe we are, or maybe you've just been hurt really bad. Let's have a conversation. Right? Let's have a conversation, because oftentimes it could be a bit of both. I always can grow in more love. I can always excel because there's so much more of God that I want. If you tell me I've hurt you, I'll be quick to apologize. I might not I might not understand that I felt that I was doing that, but that doesn't mean I don't want to reconcile things. I want to understand God's heart for people. And I'm not going to understand it in my little cave, hiding away from people. Yeah. To all my introverts out there. I'm like not quite half, but I have a fairly introverted side that likes a little bit of peace and quiet. I like a little alone God time. I like to get away from everybody. I like to, hey, Tracy, if you're going to keep talking, can y'all just go over there? I'm just going to lock and shut everything. I just want me and God right now. Or right now, I just want me and me. Y'all just go away too. And so I'm not sure that the second one's quite as healthy as the first one. But so here's where this is going, right? Daniel is like literally a model of purity in the people. Like he's living such a pure life. Here he is. He's been a eunuch, and he's living for God. He's interpreting dreams. He's as high up as a slave could get in a foreign country. So he's gotten a place of authority, and the guy started out 14 years old. Daniel started out 14 years old when he was brought into Babylon, and all these things happened. And so here we go. When we talk about fasting and prayer, I always say that Jesus in everything, Jesus is our model, right? Jesus is our model. Yes? All right. I got everybody's attention. Is Jesus your model? All right, good. Because if Jesus is our model, then this is what you need to see. Jesus goes to John the Baptist. John the Baptist says, I shouldn't baptize you because I'm not worthy to even untie your sandal. Now you're telling me to do something I'm not worthy to do. Jesus says that the scriptures would be fulfilled. You're going to baptize me. He gets baptized. The dove descends. He's filled with the Spirit. The Spirit leads him into the wilderness for a season, 40 days of fasting and prayer. In the season, he's tempted with a voice that sounds just like God mixed with a lot of self. Listen, God, the way you know God's voice is it's oftentimes not so concerned with you. God has a purpose that's much bigger than you. And if it's all about you, now I'm not saying not some. Listen, every part of the body that does something in the body. If I'm a heart and I'm pumping, I'm all about blood. I'm pumping blood. I'm doing my job. Guess what? There's part of my circulatory system that's going to feed me. When I minister, I'm getting ministered to. I'm giving out, but I'm getting back from the Lord. And it's always a cycle, but my primary function is not for me. My primary function is to give, and in giving, I'm receiving. Okay? If you were lungs, your job would be oxygen. And no matter, if you're given oxygen, you're just giving oxygen to the blood. But guess what? The blood's giving life back to you as lung cells, the liver, whatever you want to say, okay? So I'm not saying that God's intentions aren't for you. What I'm saying is they're not all about you. See the difference? When we come to church, we get a notion that God wants to make my life better. God doesn't want to make my life better. God wants me to be crucified. How's that? Jesus is not trying to make my life better. Jesus has required. Everybody know that word? Required that I be crucified with Christ. It no longer be I who live, but Christ living in me. And the life I now live, I live for the only begotten of the Father. Galatians 2:20. He wants me to live only for him, for his purposes. And in that, I'm going to get more food, more blessing, more love, more appreciation, more of everything God has. And sometimes it might seem like that thing is struggling, that thing is restricted, and no one cares, and no one sees me. Guess what? I'm back in a crucifixion phase. I'm back in a God taking me off the shelf and bringing me over to himself. And you could be preaching, everybody could love you, and still I've heard preachers say, I leave the pulpit feeling like I'm lonelier than any. I'm sitting here watching people get touched and healed and set free, and I go home feeling alone. Happens all the time. See, Pastor Jackson just said it. He's been there. I've been there. You could be there on the prophetic team. Everybody's getting prophecies, and you're, oh, everybody's getting prophecies. Everybody's getting touched. They're all dead on. I can't even get a word for myself. The reality is, guys, that God is giving us the Spirit of the Lord for everyone around us. And if that can stay our focus, we can stay a lifeline of heaven. That's what he wants. He wants me to be a lifeline of heaven. And automatically, these things are going to be added to me. So in this scripture, there was Jesus is coming. Like, as the model, he goes in filled with the Spirit, but comes out filled in power. Now watch this. I didn't have as much time to explain this the first service. He goes in one way, filled with the Spirit. It's kind of like a nice cup of wine. He goes in, filled with the Spirit, but he comes out filled with dynamite. Okay? He went in filled with the Spirit, but he came out filled with power. If you want to know what you're supposed to be doing, you're supposed to be upgrading every commodity that you have in life. If you got a little, you know, if you're doing things, you know, someone does you wrong, you can say, well, I can judge them or I can give them mercy. Okay, I got a little mercy in my bank now. I'm sowing mercy, I'm reaping mercy. Guess what? I want to upgrade this because I want to start giving people what they don't deserve. I'm going to get some grace out of this, and then grace becomes my upgrade. Well, here is being filled with the Spirit, time with the Lord, time alone. Guess what? If you take it up a notch and you say, you know what? This time has been so incredible. God's been over this church and God's been so touching us. And you say, what would happen if we take it up a notch? I would like to go from being filled with the Holy Spirit to being endued with power from on high. Now I get it. We're all endued with power. And Jesus said, the authority I have, guess what? I'm going to give that authority to you. But sometimes I go to pray and I'm like, here's everything I got. And they're like, can I get in somebody else's line? And you're like, man, what happened? Like last week I was thunder and lightning. This week I'm fizzling out. And it happens. It's an ebb and flow of life. And why get upset about it? Just know when things are pulling back, God's trying to call you in. God's calling you in because he's trying to upgrade some of that supernatural, some of that filling, some of all that prayer, all that praise, all that worship. God's trying to take it and turn water into wine. He's trying to turn wine into dynamite. He's trying to become explosive through you. So Jesus has this experience. He breathes on his disciples, sends them out two by two, and they come back. What do they say? Demons are subject to us. This is awesome. He says, well, that's not actually that important. Sounds cool, preaches great, just not that important. Your name written in the book of life is actually really important. You should probably be rejoicing that your names are written in the book of life rather than the fact that what's under you, that should be under you, is under you. Like, you got in line and things worked that were supposed to work. That's not that exciting. Except it was exciting because you didn't know that you were supposed to be in authority. So we're talking about authority here for a second because Jesus has this ultimate upgrade. Then he sends his disciples out and they're casting out demons. They're healing the sick. All these miracles. The disciples. By the way, this would be pre-salvation if you really get technical. The disciples technically are not saved. Especially, I mean, all 70 of them, definitely, you haven't even heard their names. You don't even know their names. And they're all doing it. Why? Because Jesus breathed on them. What's that? That's like God breathing in the garden into his people. Breathing life. Guess what? God breathed into your lungs today. And if you have the intention, you get to let life or you get to let death come out of that same breath as you intentionally form it by your words, by your mouth, uttering what you want to come out to the world around you. You get to choose life and death. And so, this kind of authority, this man brings his son. We can actually read it. Joseph, can you read that? I think it's a great. I have a little bit too much. I think we'll skip down a little bit. Yeah.
Okay.
You could skip the part about the Pharisees and stuff.
Okay. Matthew 8 or Mark 9?
Sorry. This would be Mark 9.
It would be Mark 9. Okay.
Start with verse 20.
Verse 20. Yes, sir. And they brought to him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear at him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, how long is it ago since this came to him? And he said, of a child, since he was a child. And often it cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. And straightway the father of the child cried out with and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help you my unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying to him, you dumb and deaf spirit, I charge you, come out of him and enter him no more. And the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him, and he was as one dead, so that many said, he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he was come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, why couldn't we cast him out? And he said to them, this kind can come forth by nothing but prayer and fasting.
Now this scripture is phenomenal, and it's laced with all kinds of things. One thing I want to say is that a lot of times we say the prayer and fasting is actually what cast out the demon. Prayer and fasting doesn't cast out demons. Prayer and fasting casts out doubt. The reason why you can't cast out demons is because you doubt. The reason why you can't say to mountains be removed is because you have doubt. It's not the demon so strong or the demon won't let go. And no, it's because in me there's doubt that's not letting this be accomplished. And when I become aligned in heaven by fasting and prayer, I start to see that God wants to use me to set this poor son free. And that might sound challenging to you because it's much easier to blame everybody but me. Notice I said me, not you, because that feels better, right? It feels better? Chase has been teaching me a long time, like, you got to watch what you say here, honey. I don't always, like, think about what I'm saying. In fact, I very rarely think about what I'm saying. It just comes out, and I go, oh, thank you, Jesus, for making it so sweet. But here's the thing. If I'm not aligned with what God wants to do, I'm not going to speak what God's speaking, and I'm not going to stay true to it. You know, when I was reading the book from Mahesh Chavda, he was talking about a little boy. He said, God, why would you send me here? This kid keeps beating his face. And it's a whole children's hospital with kids that are completely handicapped, hurting themselves and everything else. They started shock treatments on the kid. And he was like, you know, he got worse. He got shock treatments, and then he beat himself worse. He had black eyes. His face had turned into alligator skin because he beat himself. Like, I'm talking about every hour on the hour, the kid's beating his face. And he's just mutilating himself. And Mahesh, every time Mahesh would come near him, the kid would just put his head on his chest and cry. Mahesh was a graduate. He's a Baptist seminary, and he has his license through the Baptist church. And it's amazing because as he's dealing with this young guy, he gets to a point where they bind his hands, splint his hands, and tie his hands to his side. So the kid can't even use his arms to beat himself anymore. So then the other kids start pushing him down. And because he couldn't catch himself, he would land on his face and bust his face on the ground. And so Mahesh is breaking for this kid, and God's like really doing a work in him. Like, can you feel how I feel about this kid? And then listen, because as much as you're feeling what you feel for the kid, would you do what Mahesh did next? God said, this kind only come out by prayer and fasting. And Mahesh starts hearing it and he goes, what's that? He never even heard the scripture, even though he had a 4-year degree out of seminary. So he goes and just completely stops drinking and eating immediately. As soon as the Lord said it, he stops eating and drinking and starts finding it in the Word of God. He finds this kid who's convulsing, And he starts really getting faith. After the third day, the Lord says, you can start to drink water now. I'm saying this because we all act like we have compassion. There's a difference between having a, oh, I'm sorry, and oh, I'm willing to die for you. Do you see a little difference? Is there a bit of difference between I'm willing to give my life for you and I'm, you know, I'm a little concerned about the way you keep beating yourself? There's a big difference. And after the 14th day of not eating and being on water, the Lord says, now go and pray for him. So he comes into the room and they bring him in, the kid, and he goes, now, I know you probably won't understand anything I'm saying to you, but your spirit will understand. He says, I command the spirit of mutilation to loose you now. It said the kid flew across the room, hit the wall, was 3 feet off the ground on the wall. And as he slid down, he started crying. Mahesh undid the bands off his arms, undid the splints. And the kid was crying and started feeling his face for the first time in love for himself. Now, we talk about things, and I'm trying to say that it's really important that you understand there's a difference between being compassionate and the Spirit of the Lord putting agony on you for his people. And you aren't going to get to a place where you can change a people by just sitting passively by and feeling bad. We felt bad long enough. We felt bad and we've done our best long enough, but our best just wasn't good enough. There are people that need to come into this place and find a place of deliverance. They don't need to find a place that says, oh, it's okay, God understands. God doesn't understand because God took 3 nails to deliver you from that. He took 3 nails to destroy the works of darkness. He took beatings so that we could be healed. He's not okay with sickness. He doesn't think it's good for one extra day. It's not okay for our excuses to make our Bible smaller. Or our God, human size. God wants to challenge us to be God size, not us to challenge him to be human size. God's stirring up in us a desire to bring a place where people can come and be completely transformed. And it doesn't have to take forever. It's one encounter with Jesus. I don't know how it happened for you. But one time I went to a revival. I went to this revival and I said, I want God. I have to have God. If I go back, I'm going to be a drug addict even longer. I can't quit using drugs. I'm at this revival in Florida and I say, I'm going. And guess what? They were like, well, some of us are going to go to prayer. That's the thing you do. Some people think it's like this, but sometimes you do it on the ground, and it's actually talking to God. That's called prayer. And it's not something you do before every meal. It's something you do as often as possible. It's a communication line. I'm being silly because this is how my heart was, and when we have open prayer, you have an opportunity, but do you take the opportunity? Here's what I did. I was desperate, guys. I've been a drug addict. I've been smoking PCP, LSD, mescaline, peyote. I mean, that's just the hallucinogen family. Shrooms, and we could just keep on going through the other world, right? I was desperate for God. I've been a drug addict. I almost ruined my life. I almost got myself, you know, out of college, and I ended up still graduating with a great, great GPA because the Lord intervened. And here's what happened. I go, and they say, we're going to prayer. And I'm looking at the older people saying we're going to the prayer. I'm looking at the younger people saying, oh, we're just going to play games. And I was like, I didn't come 18 hours to play games. Y'all have a good time. I'm going to go with the older people and we're going to go pray. And that's the place I had the encounter where literally hundreds of people were singing out to God And I was looking like, where is the organ in this place? I was looking for everybody playing instruments because there was so much music coming. I was like flooded by music and I was like, what is going on? I'm looking, there's nobody on the stage. Just so many people praying that I thought music from heaven. And I was like, you're like orchestrating like all these people praying. And even sounds like angels are, I'm like, this is too real for me. And so I go to prayer. I get this awesome encounter with God. I go back. I'm so stirred and hungry for God. I go back the next day. Every altar call, I ran to the front. I was probably first to almost every single altar call out of thousands of people. I mean, I literally remember by the third time I got it down, I was like, because we would sit in line at 6 o'clock in the morning to get at church at 7 p.m. Then when I would stack my chair, they made me go to the back because I was in the steel chairs in the front because I got the best seat in the house. I folded up my chair. I stuck it there. They make me go to the back. And now as I'm in the back, I'm literally like, this is my altar call. This is where I got down knocking down the grannies, Tracy. Sorry. Everybody that gets in the way, I'm going to be hitting that altar call. Now, I'm not saying I was always first, but from the very back of the church, I would, as fast as I could, and just dive on my face. And I did it every single night. And one night, this person comes up to me and says, do you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Did you know there's a room that they have here just to get the baptism of the Holy Spirit? And they will tarry with you until you get it. I was like, I'm finding it. I'm going to find it. Tell me who they are. Where are they at? And it was so crazy. The whole next day, the young people said, we're going to go to the beach. And I was like, okay, I guess I could go to the beach. I've been fasting a little bit and I've been praying. And you know, I feel like I've kind of been like by myself. I'm going to do something together. I got lost and drove all the way from Pensacola to Mobile, Alabama. It's about 1 hour and 10 minutes. That's a long time when the beach was 10 minutes. What happened was I was listening to this song called Baptize Me by Crystal Lewis. And I just kept listening to this song. I was like, I'm going to get it. I'm going to get it. I'm going to get it. I end up in Mobile and I'm like, you got to be kidding me. Why am I in Mobile? I get out of my car and I walk and I look at the ocean and I say, I was born here. I get back in my car, I say, that's a good sign. I get back in my car, I drive all the way home. I say, forget the beach. I picked up the guys. We went to the church. I got in line and I got in. And this witch comes up to me. And she says, I just feel like, you know, you're really going after something. And I really feel like it just might not happen. And I don't want your hopes to be that high. She said this. We were in the church. She goes, can we go outside and talk? She said, can we go outside and talk a little while? And I start going, I don't think you sound like Jesus. And I don't think I like what you're saying. And I don't know why you wanted me to go outside when we're in a spiritual place. And I was like, I don't know anything about spiritual warfare or any of this other stuff, but I know I don't like you. Actually, I had a big heart for her, but I just wasn't in agreement. So I said, I'm going to get it. And I remember I went, the altar call started, and I ran and I found some ushers. I said, where is this place that they're going to pray with me until I get the baptism of the Holy Spirit? They took me around there. I got filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and I'm speaking in tongues, and I'm filled with the Spirit, and I'm all excited about this new Holy Spirit. I come out, and I'm like, oh, good, they're still praying. And Steve Hill comes around the corner, and he's about right there. I was like, oh, I'm going to get prayed for. Steve Hill came up to me, and as he prayed for me, it was like I saw a fireball come and just hit me in the stomach. And I remember just going, well, I don't remember this. I remember getting off the ground. And I come back, woo, and I'm on the ground. I get up off the ground, and it looked like the sea of people just got split. And I don't know if you could realize what it looked like, but it was literally like five people trying to push into your favorite concert, trying to get somebody to pray for them. I mean, they're like, they didn't care who you were, Tracy. That's why I got this. Because they were like, grandma, you know, grandmas were uppercutting people like, get out of my way, Sonny. You know, they were getting, everybody was going after it. So I get up off the ground and I'm like, that was crazy. And then the weirdest thing is that I'm 20 feet back and I don't know how I got through all those people. So I was kind of like, that's weird. So I'm sitting there contemplating, yeah, I just got hit by a fireball. I just got filled with the Spirit. And I was like, wow, that's awesome. Thank you, Jesus. And I go to get up, and I literally can't stop shaking. So bad. I mean, when I talk about shaking, y'all thought I was shaking. Like, y'all saw me shaking on there. That's how I was shaking trying to walk. For 3 days. For 3 days like this. Like your legs shaking, and I'm trying to eat, and my hands shaking. I'm trying to figure out how this is going to work. I said, maybe I'm not supposed to eat because this is really tough. If you're hungry for the things of God, you're going to find yourself filled with the things of God. So, you know, I had a good church home later in life that helped me learn some things that I should do and some things I shouldn't do, and just like all of you. But here's the thing. I got hungry for the things of God. I heard about a guy named David Hogan, and I started studying his life. I started studying how he was just moving in the Spirit, casting out demons. Sick were being healed. The dead were being raised. Blind eyes were opening. Deaf ears were healing. Hearing, and this was constant for him. He had congregation members that were raising the dead. I'm talking about dead people with lye on top of them that had been dead for days. Actually, somebody reminded me of the story where the mom drugged the son that already had the lye on him, drugged the son for 2 days through the woods, and brought the son after she drugged him. I guess maybe she built a stick thing, but she drugged the son with the lye on him and said, heal my son, bring him back. That kind of stuff should stir you up. It was in the Bible, but let's say you don't want that. Do you want sickness to keep reigning in those around you? Do you want to see another person have cancer? I'm on an assignment to destroy the works of darkness. And if it isn't happening where I'm at, I'm going someplace new. Did you hear me? If it doesn't happen where we're at, we're going someplace new. We had someone that was epileptic, that was technically demon-possessed, kept seizing. And then every time I put oil like near her lips, she go, arr, and I'm like, you're supposed to be seizing. You're not supposed to be growling at me or biting at me. That's weird, okay? So I'm like, I think it's bigger than an epileptic seizure here. So later, like we had prayed like 3 times. I'm like, God, this is not okay. And I remember like we were laying in bed and I looked over at Tracy and I said, Tracy, how can you live with yourself? Because that's what I'm feeling. How can you live with yourself letting someone be like so broken, so stuck, so bound? And it started stirring something in us. And it was awesome because the spirit that was in operation was very contrary to the spirit that we thought it was, which made us really not have a lot of authority because we're calling the wrong things, and just it was something that wanted to get attention. And as soon as Tracy denounced the fact that it wasn't ever going to get attention again in its life, it left immediately. Never had a seizure again. Never had any of that stuff. But it was because we started like hurting in our hearts and had compassion for the person that was in that state. So in this place of authority, it says that this man whose son was seizing up, he says, like, he doesn't have that much faith. Help my unbelief. Jesus' disciples had already prayed for him. People thought he was dead. I mean, Jesus is like, how long is this going on? The guy's over here seizing, and Jesus wants to connect with the Father's heart. How's your heart feeling right now? And as Jesus connects with the Father's heart, the Father really starts understanding his inability to help his son at all. See, when you start to understand your inability to help, I mean, what will it take before you get really tired of it? How close to home does sickness have to come before you realize I'm not having it? Let me tell you this. Oftentimes when the sickness comes, it's too late to try to find authority. If cancer comes to someone in your family, and we rebuke that in Jesus' name, if it were to ever happen, it's too late for you to get a cancer-breaking anointing. You're not going to get it overnight. You have to hate cancer today to come to a place where if it gets anywhere near anybody I know, I want to destroy that thing. You have to hate it with the hatred that God hates it with. And when I hate it like that, I'm going to manifest God's fury and God's authority against it. I don't have the time to waste waiting on a time when I'm going to get frustrated with where things are in my life. I'm constantly feeling like I would need to go so much further. And here's the thing. God's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. The vault is mine. The doors are open. That's great. The problem is I don't know how to get to the bank. It's like the keys are in the lock. The door's wide open. The vault is full. That's what we preach about. The problem is there's no directions to the bank. If I knew the directions to the bank, I would start having the authority that is in the bank. So the treasures that are locked up in Christ Jesus are actually accessed through access points, or what the Bible calls keys. There are keys to access supernatural things. Just like if I want to access supernatural provision, I need to be a supernatural giver. You can't bring supernatural things and you can't mismatch, because otherwise, I like Mike Murdoch's version of this. Mike Murdoch says, If you think that prayer will bring out all the finances, then I guess the mafia is the most praying group in the world. And those missionaries really need to step up their game in prayer, because they're really always needing money. No, the mafia knows how to give money and keep it in the family and do all the stuff. That's principles of God. I'll move on. Last point on authority is about the centurion's great faith. The centurion is a man who was, the word century is 100. He was a man over 100. He was a leader of 100 men, an army of 100. And he comes to Jesus and he says, I need a healing for my servant. And he says, Jesus says, okay, well, I'll go. And he says, you don't need to go to my house. I don't think I'm worthy for you to go to my house. But if you speak the word, my servant will be healed. Okay? So here's the interesting dynamic here. This is an unbeliever, barely knows who this Jesus is, but he's seen this Jesus operating in authority. And he says, because I see the authority that you have, because when you say things, they happen, because that's what I'm seeing, I know that if you speak it, it will happen. Just like when I speak it to one of mine under my 100, if I say go, he goes, and if I say come, he comes, and that's how authority works. Because I'm a man under authority, I've been given authority over 100. Listen to this. If we start understanding that principle, then we'll start stewarding well the authority that we have today so we can get to greater depths of authority. It's not about whether you have authority now or not. It's not about getting offended about me saying you don't have enough. I'll just say I don't have as much as I want, and you can decide what you want. How's that? I take serious prayer and fasting because it's unlocked so many amazing doors. We had two people get healed last week. Just in the midst of prophetic declaration and praying for a couple people. We're expecting to see a lot more of that as we continue to believe God. And those were physical things that they could tell. Obviously, we prayed for some things that were not physical that you can't tell without going to the doctor. So, when Jesus releases the word, they find out his servant was healed that same hour, right? All this is about faith, and great authority. Authority is given when I walk under authority. And one thing I've learned is that the more I walk under authority and the more I'm willing to let people give me advice, as you might say, you know, when there's wisdom in the multitude of counsel, you guys heard that? That's all about counsel, me submitting to counsel. But if I say, what, I'm the pastor here, I don't have to listen to this nonsense, it's not what I want to do, I'm in trouble because I'm not yielding to what is given. And I'm saying this, guys, because I get it. We've all been hurt in church. We've all been hurt in church. We could compare horror stories all day long. And it wouldn't make a difference on what do we do, where do we go from here? The reality is I'm at a place where I don't care what happened to me yesterday. I learned the best, and I learned what I don't want to be. I learned what God doesn't want for my church. Now I have to move on, and I need to see what God has for me today, because you know what? No matter what it seemed like, I did everything I did unto God. And you know what? When all the people that got hurt, they got hurt by the same things that I didn't get hurt by. You know why? Because they thought some man took their money. I never gave my money to a man. I'm blessed, and they're complaining. It's like they're so hurt and miserable and broke, and I'm blessed and I'm thankful that a person was willing to stretch me beyond my measure. Stretch me beyond what made sense. And I stretched and stretched and stretched and stretched and stretched and stretched and stretched. So much so, I told you guys that within five or 6 years, Tracy and I were giving the same that we made 5 or 6 years before. That happened because somebody stretched me. Now I could sit there and go like, I can't believe this guy got so much money from me. Or I could say like, look how much more money I made. Holy moly. How did this happen? How did I go from making $50,000 to making $300,000? Like, that's serious. That was a long time ago, but it was good. It was a good time. And here's the thing. If we don't submit ourselves, we won't find the blessings in what people have access to. And I'm personally getting more and more interested as I get older in what people bring in their DNA to be able to yield to. Because Mahesh, as he wrote this book, he said he spent 130 days a year fasting. 130 days. That means he fasted one-third of his life for 20 years. One-third of his life for 20 years he didn't eat. And he said that's because in secret, he didn't tell people at the beginning. This is all private stuff. Because God was showing him, the Baptist church didn't show him this stuff. The Lord showed him this stuff. And he went in for it, and he was revealed to him. And he says, now I can say that I have authority in this area, and I can impart that authority to other people because I paid for it. And I'm sitting there going, this is so awesome. This man's paid all this so that I can have it at a much lower price. Not free. I didn't say free. He still said I have to fast, but he says I don't have to do all the 40-day fasts or whatever, you know, but here's the thing. There's some people in here with DNA that's been put in you. And if you'll begin to master it, I was talking to Joseph about mastery, the concept of mastery, to be the best at something, to be the go-to guy for something, means that that's been your core focus for at least 10,000 hours of your life, which is about 5 years full time. Or 10 hours a week, it would take you 20 years. So the more you're putting into the thing you want to master, you're not going to master everything. And Mahesh is sitting here saying, I've been able to master one thing in my life, and I'm giving it to you in this book. And I'm like, this is so awesome. Like, I just love this. This is how God wants to multiply his children and the children's children, by being able to impart to others what God's already given to you. So I pray that you really let your heart be softened to the thing that people are out to get you. I'm certainly not. I have enough to get myself. It's enough work to get myself. I'm not out to get anyone. I want people to just go after the promises that God has for you and find those access points and those keys. And we're going to do this activation here that I want you guys to be involved in as we close here.
Amen. Hallelujah. Wasn't that good, guys? It was so good. Praise Amen. The Lord. Let's give
Thank
God praise
Lord.
For it. Again, the purpose of this fast, the purpose of fasting is always made known by God. And now that we understand the purpose, now we have to work the purpose. We have to do some application. And how do we do that? We got to pray it out. And so that's what we're going to do. So the question becomes, how do we need to pray? So when I was asking the Lord, I was like, how do you want us to pray? And I saw us doing a three-part activation. Okay, it's only going to take just a few minutes. But I said, how do we pray? And he said, in the Spirit. And I said, well, what's in the Spirit? Do you mean tongues? Do you mean what? And he said, in the Spirit is the place where you know God speaks and you can hear him. The place where you know God speaks and you can hear him. So that's what we're going to do. So right now, in this activation, everybody just shake yourself real quick. I see some of y'all like, wake up. So we got some work we're going to do. We're going to do this little activation here. And what I saw in my spirit, the first thing that we're going to do is remember what I had said that the purpose of this fast that Pastor David and Pastor Tracy said on New Year's, one of the things they said was that we would begin to walk in and live out the prophetic words spoken by the Lord over this house. The first thing that we're going to pray about in the spirit is these prophetic words. Are these prophetic words that has been spoken over the house? Everyone in here has been here one time or another where you've heard some sort of prophetic word over this house. Even if you were in here just a minute ago, Pastor Tracy said, there's kids coming in. There's children coming in. There's souls coming in. That's a prophetic word. A prophetic word is there's repentance. There's cleansing going on in this house. That's a prophetic word. So right now, for just about 2 to 5 minutes, I want you guys to get in your heart. If you have to walk around and pray, walk around. You can make your chair an altar. You can do whatever you need to do to just get in God, get in your place in God. You can come up to the front, whatever. It's going to be, we're going to pray. And while we're praying, this is what I saw. One thing we're going to do when we pray is ask God questions about this. If it's about a cleansing, okay, Lord, what about the cleansing? What do you want? What is that going to look like, God? Who is it going to involve? Do you want me involved in it? What's my part? Okay, if I have that, okay. How do you want me to pray about this? Asking God questions and him interacting with you during this time for, again, the understanding for these prophetic words for this house. So that's the first activation that we're going to do. The second one, I'll tell you guys after this 2 to 3 minutes. So I want you guys to just go ahead and just get in God, and I'm just going to lead you guys, and we're going to pray in the Spirit. So we'll just pray together corporately. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for your faithfulness and your goodness and your love. And we thank you for the opportunity to partner with you this afternoon. Oh, it's a good place to know that you not only have something that you want done, but you actually are willing and wanting to work with us to get the job done. So, Lord, we say yes to you. We say yes to the assignment that you have for us this evening to pray out the plan and to pray out the purpose of God that you have for us and for this house at this time, in Jesus' name. Now go ahead and just begin to pray and ask the Lord questions about these prophetic words over this house. Thank you, Father. Go ahead, close your eyes. Don't look at me. Don't look at anybody else. Ask the Lord. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah. Kanamosa kenda broshete. Brando do sequeta. Yes, Father. Great and effectual doors. What doors do you want open? We pray about those doors, Lord. Ebrasundodores. Andasundere bra asinda. Yes. Yes, Lord. I see that. Amashta. And Zabongale Nebikaha. And a beacon, Lord. I lift up that beacon of light. Abrasto. And the Zunzamanda Sika and Dora Geisha. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes, Lord, yes. You did say that. You said that there would be even times where there would be doors open to the government, Lord, for this house and for Pastor David and for Pastor Tracy. Father, what is that? What door? Who? Who is the door? Who is the door, Lord? Emros Sekenda. And Zumbara Shende Ebrasa. Yes, Lord. Yes. Azuzuta. Azuzukoroma Ajita Abrata. Mendo Sunde Lebrashta. Come on. Andazuta. Just a few more minutes. Izuzura Baka. We pray about these prophetic words, Lord. Andazuka Nanamarishita. Yes. Yes, yes, it is. It matters to you. It matters. It really, really matters to you, God. It matters to you. This is so important to him. Andazumbra Eshita. Aspronde. And the Sondora the Mandurushe. Oh, recede brondilibra. Rushendiro Rusura Bakaya. Manguri Shondilibrasa. Come on, don't lose heart. Indurusse Yamasata. Andazunda. Now that's just birth that out. Birth out what you're seeing. Birth out that prayer. Birth out that plan. Birth it out in prayer. Anzuzumbra. Yes, Sita. Yes, Lord. It's a season of birthing. It's a season of birthing. Amorige. Morigindu Zumbra. Zumbre Shito. Rusa. Reindu Solibresti Andorige. Manguri Sheta Brosteheda.
Come on, I see the Lord raising up pillars. The Lord is saying, I'm raising up pillars, even out of ashes, even out of people that have given up on the life. Yeah. I see that the Lord is raising up pillars.
Yeah.
You think the Lord wants to run by and bring someone else, but he's looking at you today. He's calling you out from among them. He's saying, it's you that I want to use. You're going to be a pillar in my house. You're going to be a pillar in the temple of the Lord.
Yes,
and the Lord's going to raise you up to have truths that people are going to come to ask you about those things that the Lord has called you to master. He's called you to be a pillar in a truth that he's set upon your heart, that you would come and you would be his people. You would come and be a pillar in the house of the Lord. And I just sense all over this place that as that spark is beginning to happen, begin to ask the Lord, cry out. God, make it happen.
God, make it
allow
happen.
It to happen in me.
God,
let your truth be for me.
Yes.
God, how is it going to be?
Yes.
What must I do to be saved? Come on. Whatever it takes, God. Come on, let there be an abandonment in you. Jesus.
We yield to you, Lord. We yield our spirit, our souls, our bodies to you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Thank you, Father. Let's just pray real quick, just for a minute, about those pillars. So that's a great example. That was a prophetic word. Now let's partner with God to ask him, okay, what's that going to look like? What do you want that to sound like? Who do you want to use in that, Father? Andusuta, talk to me about these pillars, Lord. What's my place in this? What's my place in this assignment? Come on, just 30 more seconds, Omosa, and then we'll move on to the next activation. Amore. Yes, yes, yes. Embracing, Lord. Embracement. Later, later. It is later, Lord. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Everyone just look up at me real quick. Hallelujah. Let's do a test this. Did God talk to you about a prophetic word that was about this house? Raise your hand if he did. Two people, three people, four, five, six. Okay, good. It's always good to check and make sure we're on point, right? Hallelujah. The Bible says in the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. So now, the next activation, we're going to do the exact same thing, But I want you to ask the Lord for yourself concerning the prophetic words personally he's spoken over you, or that others have spoken over you in this season. So we're going to go right into our same heart right there. And now I want you to just go there and ask God. Talk to him about the prophetic word that he's spoken in your life personally. We're going to do the same thing for about 3 to 5 minutes. So go ahead. I just release you guys to do that now. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes. What are you preparing me for, Father? Yeah. Yes. Yes. Sungo do bo shiketa. Ambrosin da nede bi son do do rike shaba. Yeah. Masun da nede re shiketa azuzunde. Sidzo zubala shun da nede bote le brasata. Yes. 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 Sikondo do rina bahashete. And if you don't hear anything, just ask the Lord to open your ears. Ask the Lord, say, Lord, open my ears to hear. Thank you, Lord. Mando do sikita. What prophetic word has he spoken to your heart? Nanda bo sikita la la mashitala. Ando zon de le brashite. That he wants to unlock right now. Yes, yes, Lord, what is that? Aramasita, andoto sikita ambroshe tele de mounta na narasa, andozunda na namahasita, yeah, yes, 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 hallelujah, hallelujah. I see mantles falling right now, mantles coming down from heaven on specific people for specific assignments. Father, we just release those mantles now. We release those prophetic mantles. Yes, Lord. Oh, all those, Father, all those that have been, that you've talked about concerning the prophetic. Lord, Father, I thank you for those prophetic mantles concerning the office of the prophet. And I even hear the office of the teacher. Thank you, Father. Let those mantles come now. Come now. Come now. Some of you can even feel it. Some of you will begin to feel those mantles just drop on you. It'll feel like somebody just threw a cloth right over your face. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, just 2 more minutes. Ramon conde le brando saia. Yes, Lord, we remain in you. Andoro da bale di asata. Endo zunda la brasindo do gerisha. Yes, yes, I open the door of my heart to you, Father. The door of my heart, be open, be open, be open. Yes, to declare and say what thus saith the Lord in this season and in this time. Yes, sokona ne meshata. Mando zumbre e sikita la brosete. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Now just thank him for what he's spoken into your heart. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I just saw like a white mantle fall like right here. I'm not sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
He was receiving that, but it was like a white.
Yeah.
Fiery mantle, and it was purity, but it was also a fire that was cleansing. It's going to start with you, but it's going to go out from you.
Yeah. Yeah.
I thought it was you, Wanda, but I wasn't sure. But you said it as soon as I. But if it was anybody in this area, just receive that.
Yeah.
There's a purity that's coming upon you. That's going to take away all the things that's tried to rob that purity, and it's going to make you a pillar of. When people look at you, they're going to know what the Lord has done. And we just release that right now in the name of Jesus. Did anybody else see that? Any, you saw something? What'd you see? Yeah, a white thing. Did it come on you over here? All right, awesome. A white pillar, a white mantle just fell on you. So it starts with the purity and obviously the fire of the Holy Spirit. There's a way more intention than purity, but God's highest goal is to have all of us.
Whoa.
When he gets all of us, the world just opens up and all the things he's put on your heart, they come into a place of purity. He says, yes, that thing I gave you, yeah, I want to do that too. And it's all about the Lord's attention is going to be turned so to you. And Wanda, the Lord's attention is going to be so turned to you. You're going to have the attention of the Lord. His eyes are going to be watching after you. Has anybody else here saw something similar? Maybe you saw a different color, but you saw a mantle fall. I saw a few of them fall.
Did you raise your hand, Sean? What did you see?
I did see.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. That's awesome.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And this last exercise, this last activation, I got this when you were talking, Pastor David, about the revival that you were in. And I saw it in my spirit. And then the Lord reminded me of, again, the prophetic word that Chris Burns prophesied over you. And I saw it as he was talking. Pastor David taught me a long time ago. He said, whenever you're preaching and sharing a testimony, it's always an invitation for God to do it again.
Yeah.
It's always an invitation for people to come up higher. And I saw people, if you have never experienced God in that way, if you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit, this is first for people who have never been filled with the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, this last activation is for you. Or if you have never experienced being filled with the Spirit to the point of manifesting tangible presence, like you literally feel it and you see, like Pastor David did the rock and roll and the, you know, all that. It's fun and games, but it's real. Oh, and when it's real, you know it. And it might seem weird, it might seem crazy, but it sure is a lot of fun. and it feels really good, you know. But so for this last activation, I want to call people up again. First, if you've never been filled with the Spirit, with the evidence of speaking in tongues, and I'm just going to ask if this is okay, Pastor David and Pastor Tracy could stand up here to pray for these wonderful people that do not have this, and to lay hands on them and come expecting to be filled. Yeah. Is that you? Come on. Come on. Come ex- Whoa.
There's a few of you. It's good. It's good. We're just going to tarry. We're going to believe God.
Amen.
Can I get the microphone on up here?
Yes. For Chris.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come
Thank
on.
Thank you. Just give this to them. Hallelujah. And just stand in line. Just stand in line. They're going to go right down. Billy, you, if you and whoa. And again, if this is for a two-part altar call, this is not only for those that want to be filled with the Spirit, but if you want to be filled to the point of overflowing, like he was just talking about, come up here right now too as well. Hallelujah. And just stand on this side. If that was just you, I want to call for the people first that have never been filled to stand right here with the evidence of speaking in tongues. But if you want more, if you want that tangible experience of God, come line up from this point onward, okay? Okay. If you've never spoken in tongues, stand on this to the right side of me over here. Okay? And if you just want more of God and you want that tangible fire and experience, then stand over here and between the three of us, we'll pray together. Amen. Are y'all looking? Yeah. You guys do you. Absolutely.
Carol Greenwood.
Carol.
I don't know if Ray's here.
Freddie. Yeah, Pastor George.
Pastor George. Carol, can I want you to help us specifically with this.
Unless you're catching.
Thing. And we're just gonna enter this song. This song has really been speaking to me. And I just want you guys that are up here to really get lost, because it's a supernatural work that we're coming into agreement with. This song, what's it called? Your presence is heaven. And every time I hear this song, it just takes me in. And I felt like this altar call was to call us into a place of encounter in heaven. So we just thank you, Lord, for heavenly realms being open to us in Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that you died and bled and gave yourself for us, Lord, to give us access to that same Holy Spirit that was on the inside of you. Lord, and when Peter and James, when they spoke to crowds of people, Lord, and began to tell about Jesus and the way he gave himself, Lord, the wind came in And we ask that same wind of the Holy Spirit to come in now and fill, because your presence, God, your presence is heaven to us. Yes, Lord.
Oh, Yeah. heaven to me.